100 if you are not here for Intro to Discrete Structures, COT 3100. You are in the wrong place, and I will encourage you to leave. I will not force you, but I will encourage it. Okay, I guess you're all in the right place. So, our study unions this semester are all live streamed. There is a camera right here. It can hear you. Okay, so, you know, don't be an asshat. Here, this QR code, you can review me. I would probably do it after, not before, but I would appreciate it if anyone is interested in reviewing me after the session. I would appreciate it, okay? I will move this from the screen, but you can come up afterward, take a picture with your phone, whatever you need to do, okay? So, here's how this is going to work. Jarrett and I had talked about splitting the material. So I am only covering counting, probability, relations, and functions, right? So basically the second half of the course, all right? Please raise your hand if you found counting to be the hardest part of the course. Okay, honestly, that's less than I thought. It's a decent number. It's less than, yeah, counting and probability, yeah. Oh. Okay, yes, the combinatorics section to be the hardest. For those of you who didn't raise your hand, what is hardest?
Everything.
Everything. Okay. Well, that includes counting, so that's good.
Was Bayes' theorem
counting? Bayes' theorem is under probability, yeah. So I am going to cover Bayes' theorem. All right. So this is going to be a little different than my other study unions because I'm not going to be doing just a whole bunch of problems. I'm basically going to lecture. I'm going to try to teach counting from the ground up. If you do not understand it, hopefully you will by the time we're done here. Okay? Who feels like that applies to them? Okay. That's about what I thought. All right. I have absolutely no idea how long it will take me to get through this material because it's new. If I finish and there is time to spare, I will open the floor to questions. You do not have to limit the questions to the material I'm covering. If you want to ask me about number theory at the end, that's totally okay. All right? So, let's get started. So, the absolute most basic thing that we do in counting. Suppose I have an alphabet, okay? The alphabet is a set, right? It is a set that contains some elements. In this case, the elements are characters 0 and 1. So binary, right? Now, this might seem silly. Okay, it'll get less silly, I promise. How many strings of length 1 can I make? Shout it out. Huh? 2. Okay, yep. It can either be a 0 or a 1. Very, very simple stuff. All right. The problem is there's all these equations that come into play later that are just this, but people don't see that they're just this, all right? So, the answer is given by the cardinality of A, okay? Who remembers what cardinality means? Cardinality means the number of elements in a set. Now, how many strings of length 2? Well, this is pretty easy because we can just list them all, right? We got 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1. Okay. How many elements can go into the first spot? 0 or 1. Right, there's two elements that can go here.
Two goes in.
two elements that go there, and we multiply, okay? So when they teach you counting, they talk about addition versus multiplication. And on the surface, it's like, what, are you telling me how to add? What am I, five? But actually, the important thing is not how to add. The important thing is, when do I add and when do I multiply? Okay? So the answer is, you multiply things that are related to each other. Okay? You multiply terms if they influence each other. You add things that are unrelated. What is x plus y? It's x plus y, right? You can't do anything. What is x plus x? 2x. Combining like terms. That's what we are doing, okay? So this formula here, 2 times 2, it is actually the cardinality of A to the power of the string length, okay? It was 2 squared, right? This is the formula. This is the most basic counting formula, and it is one of the 4 formulas in your book. Was that a question over there? Okay. All right. So, how many ways can I make a binary string of either length 1 or length 2? How many ways can I make a string of either length 1 or length 2? It's still pretty simple. We can just write them all out, right? We have 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. How many is that?
6.
6. Okay, so what did we do? We added the unrelated terms, right? Both of these formulas they're this. Right? The number of possible characters raised to the power of the length of the string. All right? It might seem really, really simple because I'm using the easiest possible numbers right now. All right? But as you are probably aware, it is not going to stay that simple for very long. Here is a problem for you guys to do. How many strings of length 5 can I make using the English alphabet? Now, hopefully, this is extremely easy. Does anyone not think it's extremely easy? Good. What's the answer? Sorry? Hmm? Addition? Oh, with repetition? Yeah. 26 to the 5th power. Okay. Simple, simple, simple. All right, so you bring up a great question. This is saying that you can use a letter more than once. When we made our binary strings, 00 was valid, right? What if you can't use a letter more than once? right. How many strings, length 26, can I make of the English alphabet? Okay, first, what would the answer be if we could use the letters more than once? 26 to the 26, yes. Now, what if we can't use a letter more than once? Yeah, good. So, the way we think about it is, before we had 26 times 26 times 26 times 26, etc., right? But now, if we can't use it more than once, well, we can have 26 letters here. But here, well, how many can we have? All of them except whichever one is here. So it's one less. It's 25. Then 24. Then 23. And then so on, right? So the answer becomes 26 factorial, okay? In other words, cardinality factorial. Now, what if I want strings of length 5? With no repeats from the English alphabet. What do we do? Sure. Was that a question or just an answer? Is it choose? I don't think so. You're getting a little ahead of me. So the answer is 26 factorial over 21 factorial, which is 26 times 25 times 24, 23, 22. That's it, right? It stops.
Isn't that what chooses? 26 choose 5?
Is that what chooses? Okay. That's okay. It's good to draw the connections. Now, somebody earlier said it. There's a formula that looks like this. Okay? It's a formula that looks like that. Right? What is that called? Yeah. N permute K. Right? So this question is actually 26 permute 5. That's what we did, right? We said we have to choose 26 letters and then permute. We choose 5 from 26 letters and then permute them. All right? So, to summarize so far, exponents allow repeats. Factorials do not. All right. Here's a word. So, how many ways are there to permute the letters in the word elephant? Sorry? 8 factorial. Okay, we are on it, off to a great start. Is 8 factorial the answer? No. Why? Say it again. We have E twice. We do have E twice. All right, where's my colorful pen? I had a colorful pen, here it is. All right, that would be the answer if all the letters were unique. Now, okay, so I don't know how well the colors are coming in on the screen. Can you tell that I used to?
Green and red, right?
Yeah.
Green, red, black.
Okay, so there are two E's, right? You can see that in these two permutations, the E's are in a different spot. However, the word is not unique, right? So the problem is, we have duplicate permutations. We've overcounted. We have to divide out the permutations that we've counted. So what we do is we have to say, how many permutations of red E, green E. Okay? Really simple, right? How many?
Two.
Okay. Two. Right? It's technically 2 factorial. We'll get into that in a bit. All right? So what's the final answer?
8 factorial divided by 2 factorial?
Yes. 8 factorial over 2 factorial is the actual answer. Okay. Yes. Great question. So, here's another word. Okay, how many permutations can I make of the word engineering?
Total?
Total, yes.
1 factorial over 2 factorial.
Who knows why this is right? Who totally follows? Good. Okay, good. Who's lost? Okay. Who didn't raise their hand for either one? Yeah, I know. Okay. You're right. So, why? Yeah. Okay, very good. So, the answer is 11 factorial over 3 factorial, 3 factorial, 2 factorial, 2 factorial, 1 factorial. That doesn't change the value, but it's technically there. So, why is it 3 factorial? Well, if I have 3 E's, right, how many ways can I permute them? 3 factorial, of course. Okay, the reason that I am doing this is in case anyone has ever had a hard time visualizing where all these numbers come from in these formulas. Who recognizes this formula, by the way? Okay, a decent number of you. So, the formula looks like this. Okay, it is extendable to however many variables you need. Okay, you've seen this formula before? Have you applied this? No?
Yeah, I mean, we use it.
Okay. Okay, so this formula is, in my opinion, a very important formula because it's the formula from which all the other formulas that we use are really coming from. Okay, question.
The only thing though is that the top, the numerator is supposed to be the number of places, right? But you don't have 11 separate numbers, or 11 separate letters on the top, right? So.
I do have 11, right?
You do.
Oh, so
what you mean, right?
I know what you mean.
Yeah.
M is the number of one letter, right? So if I plugged it in, right? This is 3 plus 3 plus 2 plus 2 plus 1. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So the numerator ends up adding to the length of the string, okay? And the denominator is used to divide out duplicate permutations based on shuffling of identical characters, all right? Who so far feels like they know everything that I'm talking about? Yeah? Okay. Who so far feels like counting is just really easy? Okay. So, here's a problem that we're going to do, okay? Here's a grid. So over here at 10, 15, I don't know what's there, but whatever it is, I want it. Okay. Huh? Yes. Okay. Whatever it is, I want it. So tell me how many paths there are from 0, 0 to 15, 10. Such that we don't go backwards and we only move it integer increments. 25 choose 10? How do you know?
You have to take 25 steps because you have to go up by 10, go by 15, no matter what.
Okay. So, how do you know it's choose 10? Okay, so the answer is 25 choose 10. It is the same thing as 25 choose 15. So, how does this formula help us solve this? Well, we only have two different types of characters here. Right? So that's the structure that we're going to use. We're going to say that M equals 10 ups, N equals 15 rights. All right? We can make a string, right? If it helps you to think more abstractly about the problem. If you find it very easy and you don't want to do this, that's fine, right? But if you've ever wondered why it works, okay, what we're doing is we're making a string. of length 25, not going to fill in the whole thing, okay? And we're saying, out of these 25 spots, let's pick 10 and put an up arrow in those spots. All the other spots, they're going to be filled with a right arrow. Does that seem easy? I think so. Okay. So, let's make the problem a little harder. Okay. Same grid. All right. There is now a spot that I don't want to go through. How many paths are there from 0, 0 to 15, 10 that do not go through the point 10, 7? There's more we have to do. Is there? Tell me what to do.
All the paths from 0, 0 to 10, 7 multiplied by all the paths from 10, 7 to 15, 10.
Say it again.
So all the paths from 0, 0 to 10, 7.
Okay, how many paths are there? Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I have an answer key. Does anyone not understand how we figured that out?
I understand the first part. The 10, 7, 15, 10, I don't understand why we multiply it.
You don't understand why we multiply it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when do we multiply?
When things are related.
Yeah. So there are 17 choose 10 ways to get from here to here, right? That is 10 right arrows, 7 up arrows. That's how many ways we can permute 10 right arrows, 7 up arrows. Then for each one of those paths, it can then go from here to here, right? Because you have to get all the way. So what we had to do, we had to split the paths into the first part and the second part.
Okay.
Does it make sense?
Yeah, I understand that. Yeah.
Okay.
But you wouldn't get the same answer if you added them.
You would not get the same answer if you added them. The question was excluding.
Okay.
So you have to subtract from the total, right?
But it would also be the same thing as if it had to go through that path to get the 10, 15, 10, that would also be the same answer, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so this is the subtraction rule. We use the subtraction rule because finding the ways that don't go through 10, 7 is hard, so we find the ways that do, and we use subtraction. Now, suppose there's a point right here. This point is 3, 2. All right. Now tell me, how many ways are there to get to 15, 10 that do not go through 3, 2? Somebody else tell me. There's a lot of quiet people. I want to make sure they're not totally lost and not saying anything. Right now, we're just excluding 3, 2.
Same question.
Yeah. How many ways can you go that don't pass through those points. Are you telling me the answer? What do I write? Is that it?
Oh,
All right. So that problem was the same as the other one, right? Not too difficult. Has anything we've done so far been difficult? All right. So how many ways are there to get from 0, 0 to 15, 10, excluding both this point and this point? How many ways are there to travel from 0, 0 to 15, 10, excluding both 3, 2 and 10, 7? Say it again. If I subtract both of those quantities, doesn't that mean I subtracted too much?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. Why?
Well, because when you subtracted the points that go from the origin to 10, 7, you also subtracted the paths that go from the origin to 3, 2.
Right. Some of the paths that go from 0, 0 to 10, 7 will pass through 3, 2, right? The reverse is also true. Some of the paths that go from 3, 2 to 15, 10 will pass through 10, 7. So anything that goes through both, we subtracted twice. What do we do? Add it back. What is that called? Inclusion-exclusion principle. Okay, what do we add? Okay, so tell me what to write. Tell me exactly what to write. Twelve over seven? I think I know what you are saying. 12 choose 7 is the number of ways to get from here to here, right? Okay, do I just write 12 choose 7? Or do I write 5 choose 3 here? Yeah, because you have to get all the way from 0, 0 to 10 to 15, 10. So we have to include these paths. And then we have to include these paths. Okay, what's missing? Yeah, A choose 5. Okay, so inclusion-exclusion principle is where we add back in things that we subtract twice, right? And I like to diagram that. It makes it easier to understand to me. Right? If I color in the right circle, and I color in the red circle, or the left circle red, you notice that I colored in the middle twice, right? So if I were subtracting instead of coloring, I'd have to add it back in so that we only subtracted it once. Does anyone have any questions on that? Yes.
So we picked, for the first part, we picked 5-3. So that would be from 0-0 to 3-2, right?
Yes.
And then 12-7 is, or the pass from 3-2 to 10-7. And then 8-5 or the pass from 10-7 to 15-10. Now, what if you had 2 points who were equally apart from, equal distant to 0-0?
Do you mean points that can't go through each other? Because that is a thing, right?
Right, so like say the points you were excluding were like 2-1 and 1-2.
2-1 and 1-2?
Right.
Right, so they can't go through both because you can't go down or back, right?
Right.
So that looks like an inclusion-exclusion problem, but there's actually no intersect between the two Venn diagram circles, right? Does that make sense?
Right.
So okay. Yeah, yeah, you could think of it like that. You'd have to add. All right. So, when we did this form, right, and we got 10 plus 15 over 10, 15. We noticed that there were only two characters to choose from, up characters and right characters. This is a very common occurrence in counting problems, so much so that we have special equations just for such an occasion. You guys already know what they are, okay? So let's say n equals 10 plus 15, and k equals 10, all right? This is n factorial. Let's not write it like that. Let's write n choose k. It's the same thing, right? We've been doing it all along. We just didn't call it that. All of these formulas are the same formula that we did in the very first problem. All right, that's what I really want you to take away from this. So. What would 5 choose 3 evaluate to? Okay, so n choose k looks like this. N factorial over k factorial, n minus k factorial, okay? So 5 choose 3 would look like this. 5 factorial, 3 factorial, 2 factorial, right? Now, could you evaluate that? Yeah, probably, right? As long as the factorial sign doesn't scare you. Are you guys allowed calculators?
No.
Do you need them?
We're not.
You know, you're not? Do you need them?
No, not really.
No, you shouldn't.
But the big factorial stuff, most of the time, you just leave that as you.
Yeah, like if you had 200 factorial, you'd just write 200 factorial. You wouldn't need to calculate that.
The calculator doesn't even do that. Like the most thing you do is 6.5 factorial.
Yeah. Okay. Huh?
The super letters.
Super letters?
Yeah, like that Ronald McDonald problem he had in the homework.
I don't.
Like substrings?
Like the Hillary Clinton or Ronald McDonald problem, where you make a super letter out of a group
just
of like the letter, like
the permutations.
Unfortunately, I don't know what the Ronald McDonald problem is,
like,
but probably.
It's like, how many words can, like, how many times does this word can be permuted in this?
I mean, do you guys want me to do the problem? Can someone show me the problem?
I
will do the problem. Okay. Okay.
Six or seven? Seven.
Okay, do you have it?
Yeah.
Right here. You can read it out loud to me. Camera,
loud.
Camera. Okay. All right, what's the problem?
It says Ronald McDonald, all capital letters. Ronald McDonald. It says, this question considered permutations of Ronald McDonald.
And then what do we do with it?
Consider the super letter.
Is this like all, like the A's have to be together or something like that?
Yeah, it's like A.
There's an A, B, C,
null.
E part.
Null.
It's the, it's right here.
What he's talking about is the E one. How many permutations contain the substring Olin?
Oh.
Ronald McDonald.
Okay, the substring. O-L-A-N?
D.
D? Okay. So, all right, we can do that. How do we do that? It is a pattern. It means you're going to do it, not me. So, how many permutations can we make of the word Ronald McDonald that contain the substring Oland? 10 factorial over 2 factorial? Is that the full answer? We have an answer key.
Yes, we do.
Is that the full answer?
I think that it does subtract the letters that make up the substring.
Yeah, you
subtract it out from the total number of letters. Letters added back in.
I think you can see that 10 factorial over 2 factorial. You treat Oland as one letter.
Okay. So we treat Oland as one letter. All right, so O-L-A-N-D. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 letters. That's not the full answer. What is the full answer? Okay. Because we have more than one N. In fact, we have more than one of all those letters, right? Now, does that really matter? You think it would be divided by 2? 10 factorial over 2 factorial, 2 factorial?
Five times for each letter.
Oh, 5 times?
One for each letter.
Okay. So you think I should put a 5 times 2 factorial?
Yeah.
Like that?
Yeah.
Is that right?
First of all, there's 3 D's.
There's 3 D's? You're right. There are 3 D's. Okay. Why is there 2 factorial at the bottom of 10 factorial, 2 factorial? Is it? I don't know. When Oland has a D in it, how many D's are left?
One.
Wait. If there's 1 D in Oland, there's 2 more D's. that we have to permute. So when we shuffle those D's around, we end up with permutations that just have the D swapped, right? That's where the D is coming from. Or sorry, that's where the 2 is coming from. So when... Does it matter which O is in Oland? We have 2 O's, but are they different? Now, if I drew one red and one green, maybe it'd be a little different. But does the problem care which O is in Oland?
No.
I agree, it does not. So, the 10 comes from the fact that there are 10 characters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. The 2 comes from the 2 D's that are not in Oland and can be permuted amongst themselves. Remember, Oland is not an O, an L, an A, an N, and a D. It's an Oland. It's its own thing. Okay? The problem does not distinguish the D inside Oland from the other D's. Do you question? The 2 factorial came from the fact that outside the word Oland, there are 2 more D's that may be permuted. I could draw one red and one green and then flip them around like I did before. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
All right. Huh? You don't think that's the answer? What's the answer?
I think it's...
It is 10 factorial minus 6 factorial.
Is it all over 2?
Yes.
Like that? Okay, why is there a 6 factorial? What? Okay, I'm going to walk in front of the camera. There's no real way around that.
Yeah.
It's that whole paragraph explained it.
Okay. So, the first half says 10 factorial over 2 factorial, where the 2 comes from the D's, and the 10 comes from the number of characters. Okay, but some permutations have been double counted because there are strings with 2 Olands in them. Every string with 2 Olands in them was counted twice. Once when the superletter came first and once when the superletter came second. So we must count the number of permutations that have 2 occurrences of Oland and subtract this value from our original answer, since these were counted twice. So if we have 2 superletters Oland, we are left with 1C, 1D, 1M, and 1R. Thus we have 6 letters total with 1 repeated letter Oland. Okay, so I would not write it like that. I would probably write it like this, even though it is the same. I feel like it makes more sense as far as explaining what the answer means. Okay. Yes. Thank you for the tablet. The 6 factorial over 2 factorial is the number of permutations that have 2 Olands in them. Okay. They look like this. They have 1 letter, 2 letter, C, D, R, what am I, M. Okay, you have six letters. You have six letters now, and two repeated letters. Those letters are Oland, right? So it explains that every single time both of them appear, you will count that string twice in this counting problem. So we subtract the overcounting. Are there any questions on that? Yes.
Why is it still a two-factorial in the bottom?
Because there are two repetitions of a letter. The letter is this. Because remember, I can make one green and one red, and I can swap them. Are there any other questions on that? All right. Was that a problem that you guys had to do for homework, and it like threw a lot of people?
Yeah.
Okay.
None of the teams knew how to figure it out either.
Okay, let's see. Time is of the essence, so I don't think I'm going to derive the choose function. Is anyone going to be sad if I don't derive the choose function? No, you're going to be okay. Okay. Huh?
7:23.
Thank you. Okay. All right. I know what's next. All right. A plus B plus C equals 20. All right. Assuming that A, B, and C are non-negative integers, how many equations will satisfy, how many values will satisfy this equation? How many different ways are there to satisfy this equation? So like 7, 3, 10, 8, 2, 10, et cetera. I'm not gonna write them all, big number. Auxiliary value? I think I know what you're thinking of, and we will cover that. Who knows how to solve this? Is it 22 choose 2? How do you know?
David, what's that word at the end? After and?
Diophantine equations. That's what these are called. Okay. Why? How do you know that it's 22 choose 2? It is. (20+3−1/3−1). Okay, do you understand it, or did you plug it into the equation? Okay, I am shook. So let's try to understand how bars and stars works. Okay, I think that bars and stars, as an equation, is not super useful, because whenever I read it, I think, what the heck is this? Right, but as a thought process, bars and stars is useful. What it is it's an abstraction technique to help us think about problems. So the way I'm going to think about this one is this. I'm going to make these bins. Okay, they're containers. And I'm going to distribute amongst them some ones. Right? The value of the variable is determined by how many ones are in it. So if A has 7 ones, it's 7. And B has 3 ones, and C has 10 ones. Right? So this is how I figure out how to do the problem. Well, I say, okay, how do I find a counting problem that can help me distribute these 20 ones amongst these 3 containers? Well, let's make a string. I like to make strings. That's how I solve all of my counting problems. The string is going to look like this. Right? Something like that. So all the different orderings of the ones and the bars gives us different numbers of ones amongst the different containers, okay? So you'll notice the 2 characters that we're using in our choose function are ones and bars over ones factorial, bars factorial, okay? It's the same formula that we've been using since the first problem. Now, you will notice that the number of bars is not the same as the number of variables, right? So that is why we have to include 3 minus 1. So 20 is the number of ones. And 3 minus 1 is the number of bars. 3 is the number of variables. The number of bars is different. If you do one of the problems where they're sitting around a round table, did you have anything like that in the homework? No? Okay, I probably will not go over it because you don't need to, I guess. Then you don't subtract 1, all right? You probably don't know what I'm talking about because you didn't do one of those problems. I'll move on. The 3 minus 1 is the number of bars. The number of bars is different from the number of variables. This is not the case if you solve one of the problems where everyone's sitting around a circular table. Right.
3 bars to segment.
It ends up wrapping it around itself, and one section is there at the end. So, next we're going to do A plus B plus C is less than 20. I think this is what you were thinking of with the add an extra variable. How do you do that? What do you do when it can be less than 20? Sorry? Sure. So let's put more containers than we had last time. Alright. This one's gonna be called X naught. Alright. Everything that ends up in X naught is just not added in the equation. So we have 20 ones. 3 bars. What's the answer? Choose 3. right? And the string is going to look like this. It's going to look a lot like the other string. However, everything in here doesn't count. Move it up a little bit. Yes, I can. So, did you have problems like this in the homework? One? Was it challenging? It seemed challenging before, and then it's not challenging now, right? Once you learn how to do it, it's not challenging. That's how most things are in math. Question? If it were less than or equal to, then it is possible for this to get no ones, right? If this is, does that change the answer for the one that we did? Are we wrong? Is this the answer for less than or equal to? Yeah. So, if the question had said less than or equal to, this is how we do it. But what happens if it says less than? Well, it's not that different. Here's what we have to do. We have to draw our four containers. We have to take one of the ones. We have to put it in here preemptively. We now have 19. We only are going to distribute at most 19 into A, B, and C. Now, mathematically, how different is that? 22 choose 3. Simple, right? Bars plus stars, choose one of them. No. But that was a great point. You have to remember that if it's less than strictly, I wrote equal, I don't know why, call me on it. If it's less than strictly, you can't have cases where this gets nothing, right? Up here, that's okay. All right. Are there any questions on bars and stars? All right. All right. Intro to probability. So, every single probability problem you will ever do has an answer that falls between what range?
Zero and one.
That means it's a fraction. So probability problems equal E over S, all right? Where S is the sample space. You can't spell. Okay, and this is the events that we want. Now, in theory, that's really easy because fractions are something you learned in fourth grade. But the problem is that usually finding E and finding S are counting problems, right? So if you struggle with counting, it's going to carry over into probability and you're going to struggle with it as well, even though the concept of probability is not that difficult. All right, so I'm going to start slow again. If I roll two six-sided dice, What is the probability of rolling a sum of 7? It is. Who was it? Okay, so how are you figuring out the answer? As a matrix? I'm not saying you can't, but I do not know how to do it as a matrix. Oh, I see what you did. Okay. Yeah, you could do that. A grid of the sample space. All right. So yeah, if you have small enough numbers, you can write out all the possibilities, right? And if it helps you, by all means do so. It is not always feasible. So here's how I would do it. I usually calculate S and E separately, okay? Calculating the sample space is usually easier than calculating the numerator. How many possible outcomes are there to rolling 2 6-sided dice? That is a counting problem. It is a string of length 2. The alphabet is size 6. So if we use A to string length, right, it is 6 squared 36. So how many of the possible dice rolls sum to 7? Well, in this case, it is 6. We could write them all out, but I will not do so. Would anyone like me to do so? Okay, I will not do so. So, P of 7, 6 over 36, 1/6. Yeah, okay, let me do it. So, E is the number of dice rolls that sum to 7. Okay, so we have 1 6, 6 1, 2 5. In this case, I knew because I can write them out. Right. What if there are multiple conditions? So, we have P of A, and we have P of B. We remember that I used cardinality, which is a set notation, to describe E and S. Well, we're going to use more set notation in our probability notation. All right? We're going to talk about P of A, intersect B, and P of A, union B. All right. Who remembers the formulas that allow you to evaluate these? What do they mean in math? Yeah. Okay. This is P of A times P of B. Now, P of A union B is a little more complicated. Who remembers what P of A union B is? Okay. Very nice. If I roll a six-sided die and flip a coin, what is the probability of rolling a four and flipping heads? So, reading this problem, can you tell what formula you need to use? Which one? Intersect? I agree. Intersect means and, right? So what's the answer? 1/12. How did we figure that out? The probability of rolling a four is 1/6. The probability of flipping a heads is 1/2. We just multiplied, right? Simple. Simple? Good. What is the probability of flipping a heads and not rolling a four? Five what? Five over 12. Okay, that wasn't that tough, was it? So this is the probability of not A intersect B, right? So what time is it?
It's 7:45.
Okay. I'm going to skip that part then. So we're going to talk about conditional probability. So that reads probability of A given B. Who remembers what that formula is?
C of P of A over P of intersection A, B divided by P of intersection B. I mean, not the probability of divided by the probability of
Probability of P of A. Okay, you guys are giving me the long one. Yeah, you guys are trying to give me Bayes' theorem. Okay, what's the easy one? Is it union?
There's like that. Yes.
Okay. So, P of A intersect B over P of B. Now, there's some shenanigans afoot with this equation. What is P of A intersect B? It's P of A times P of B. Plug that in, and what do you get? Okay, so if you plug in P of A times P of B over P of B, okay, you get that P of A given B is just P of A. Now, is this always true? What is it called when it's true? Independent. Okay, so if P of A intersect B equals P of A, then A and B are independent. So, if you see a conditional probability problem, do you just get to go gung-ho and plug this formula in without thinking first? No, you may get it wrong, or you may get it right, but don't roll the dice. What is the probability that the sum of two dice rolls is less than 8, given that the first roll is a 3. Two-thirds. Let's look at my answer key. How do you know?
Because on the second dice, there are two rolls that would make it 8 or greater. So there's remaining 4 out of the 6 dice rolls possible.
Okay, so we could think about all the different possibilities. So if I roll a 3 and then a 5, or a 3 and then a 6, then the condition is not met. The other 4 possibilities, the condition is met. So you notice that because these are independent, we really were only looking at the one number, right? We were only looking at the second dice roll. Two-thirds. All right. So I'm going to introduce Bayes' theorem. I'm skipping some material. I hope that's okay. If I don't, we will never finish. So, some of you were really excited earlier to tell me what Bayes' theorem is, so go ahead and do it now. Okay. Over what? P of B. Okay. So, this is not that difficult of a formula, but the question becomes, what happens when you don't know what P of B is? Okay? So, you guys remember those problems that are like 98% of the population does not have the disease, right? Well, so when you have problems like that and they don't give you P of B, okay, what do you do? Well, we have to solve for P of B, okay? So P of B is equal to P of B given A times P of A plus P of B given not A times P of not A. Okay? You will notice that these two formulas right here, these two sections of the formula, they are the same. That is not a coincidence. When you do Bayes' theorem, one of the two terms on the denominator will be the same as the term in the numerator. Okay? So one of the things that bothers me about Bayes' theorem, when people learn it, it's such a long, gross-looking alphabet soup theorem. But if you apply the theorem, it's actually pretty intuitive, in my opinion. And I think that it's actually better to maybe learn it by practicing a few problems and then looking at the formula. All right? So here's the problem we're going to do with Bayes' theorem. Save some time. Can you read my handwriting on this paper? I can rewrite it nicer, but it would take time. Yeah? Okay. Raise your hand if you have no idea what to do. Know how to start it? Okay, that's good. Raise your hand if you are still working. All right. So if you had seen this problem on the exam and we weren't obviously talking about Bayes' theorem, would you have known that this was a Bayes' theorem problem?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, that's good. So, we have to solve for these three terms. Remember, two of them are the same. Okay, so this problem is asking us the probability that your trip was obscure given that it was not fun, and that is not a vector. Okay. So the setup is probability not fun given obscure, probability obscure over same thing plus not obscure. All right. What is the probability? What is the probability that your trip is obscure? Reading from the problem, we see that the probability of O is 1 in 5, because out of every 5, you go to one obscure trip. Okay? It's given in the problem. So P of O is 1/5. What is the probability that it is not fun given that it's obscure? Well, 3/4 are fun, so 1/4 are not. So it looks like this. All right, what's the probability that it's not fun given that it's not obscure? Well, that's also given in the problem, right? All of these information is given in the problem. Half of these are fun. Well, okay. 1/2 times the probability that the trip is not obscure. 4/5. All right. Is that difficult?
Just the way I interpreted the problem, I guess, is because you said that if this year is not fun, find the probability that you went to a spot, to an obscure spot. So I just assumed that if you said if, that would be the, that would be like your B, not your A.
So if it says, if X, then B. Okay. So the given thing is if given, then what? Right? So the then is the thing they're asking you about. This is, by the way, a question right out of the foundation exams, meaning it was written by Mr. Arup Guha, probably. So I think it is a good question, and it's a good practice question to be able to read and understand what the question is asking, right? Because that's one of the tricky things about counting improbability in general. can I move on? All right. I'm going to talk about the binomial expansion theorem. Okay. X plus y to the n equals I equals 0 through n, n choose I, x to the n minus I, y to the I. All right. Do you recognize this theorem? You should, hopefully. Okay. So we can use this to help us solve probability problems, particularly when we need to find out a specific number of successes in a given number of tries, we can use this. So, if I flip a coin 6 times, what's the probability of getting exactly 4 heads? Sorry? That says exactly 4 heads. Who knows the answer? All right, so I plugged the information from the problem into the binomial expansion formula to get the answer. Do you recognize this kind of problem? Yeah?
Binomial theorem is a synonymous term for probability distribution.
That's a good question, and I don't know the answer to it. I know that the binomial expansion is actually, we first used it in one of the previous chapters to actually expand binomials, right? It is a coincidence that it applies in this case, maybe not, I don't know. So, suppose I flip a weighted coin. Such that heads occurs twice as often as tails. How does that change the answer? Which one would be 0.33? This one? Are you sure? So if heads occurs twice as often, and I want to get 4 heads. Yeah, that's it. So the value in here is the probability of the event succeeding, and this is the probability of the event failing. right? Each to the power of the number of successes, the number of failures. Does anyone have any questions on that? How are we on time?
We are on 8:05.
Alrighty. Alright. Relations. Huh? Is that okay? Okay. So, I'm going to start with this set. A, 1, 3, 5, 7. That's my set. Alright. We have some buzzwords. All right, we have reflexive, we have symmetric, we have anti-symmetric. We have irreflexive, we have transitive. All right, what do these words mean? What's reflexive? Say it again. Okay.
If R, the relation R is A times A, I guess.
Okay.
There should be A relation.
Okay. So let's write the formal definition. For all A element of the set. A comma A is an element of A relates A. All right? So that is a for all. The only thing that makes this difficult for people is the for all, in my experience. And we'll talk about why. What's symmetric? I understood what you said. All right, for all A and B that are in A,
A B
implies B A. Okay. So, not an and, right? Do they have to both be in the set?
Yes.
Really? They can both not be in the set, right? Yeah, it's an implication because they can both not be in the set. That's fine. All right, what's anti-symmetric?
That's when if A and B and A are an R, for A and B and A, A equals B plus. And there's also the contrapositive of that too.
If they're not in there, then they're not equal to each other?
Right.
Let me think about that. If they're not in there, is that the contrapositive? Let's think about contrapositive. Yeah, the contrapositive, you negate both and flip the order, right? So if A does not equal B, the set does not contain both AB and BA, right? That breaks symmetry, or breaks anti-symmetry, I guess. All right, what is irreflexive? Yep, that's it. Okay, what's transitive?
A, B, A, C, therefore, A, C.
All right. A, B, and B, C together imply A, C. All right. Are there any questions about what they are before we do some problems with them? I find that if you know what they are and you know material from earlier in the class, it's not really that tough. But that is just me. So, I'm going to give you a set A, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to give you a relation. All right. Take this and make it closed under reflexive, transitive, and symmetric, okay, individually. So we're talking about closure . How do we make it closed under each term? Two, two, three, three, four, four, five, five, right? All right, so reflexive is pretty simple. Add every term A comma A, right? Now, symmetric, what do we do? Sorry? Okay, so we have to add 2, 1, and 3, 2. I'm not going to rewrite the other ones. You know the other ones are there. Because when asked to make it closed, do you remove ordered pairs? No, you add them. Question.
So my biggest issue with understanding the, when I'm trying to categorize whether they're reflexive, symmetric, whatever, is do they have to have all the elements of A? We're not adding like 4, 5, and 5, 4 to make it symmetric, right?
You are right. Now let's take a look at those definitions again.
For symmetric, do you add the 3, 3, I mean the 4, 4, the 4, 5? They're in there, right? Yeah. For symmetric?
What?
Do
you have to add? So, symmetric. For all AB, AB implies BA. What happens if the left side of an implication is false? It is vacuously true. So, if I have neither 4, 5 nor 5, 4, is it symmetric?
Yes.
Yes, because it only cares that AB implies BA. It doesn't care to have every single symmetric pair in the relation. It cares that every pair in the relation is symmetric. Do you see the difference between those two things?
Yeah. No. The answer is no.
Huh?
The answer is no. You don't have to include 4, 4, and 4, 5, 5, 5.
Correct. Okay. Transitive. Let's make it transitive.
Add 1, 3.
Okay. Easy, right? So, let's look at some new sets. Huh? 13? Okay, I'm not worried about it. A equals 1, 2, 3. It's a set. B equals 4, 5, 6. How many possible relations can be made of the form A relates B. How many relations can we make? B to the A?
The elements of the number of elements in B to the number of elements of A?
Not quite. I think I heard it over here in this corner. What's the answer?
2 to the ninth.
2 to the ninth. Where did you get that? Huh? Glinos said it?
Yeah, it's not. It's 2 to the ninth square. Yeah.
2 to the n squared? Let's stick with. Yes, let's stick to this, 2 to the A times B, okay. So those are cardinalities again, right? Cardinality, yes.
I was just going to say that the 2 represents the string length, right?
The 2 is the alphabet and the exponent is the string length, remember? So now the way this works is if I drew a string, right, 1, 4, 1, 5, 1, 6, 2, 4. I'm not going to draw them all, right? If I drew a string, I could act like each character represents a possible ordered pair that could go in the relation. And it is either in or it is not. So what I'm doing is I'm assigning a value of true or false to each of the 9 characters, okay? So there are 2 things this can be, 2 things this can be, 2 things that can be, true or false. If it's true, it's in the relation. If it's false, it is not, right? This is the same formula we've been using since the first problem. I want you to see it. Does it make sense? Okay, totally quiet, crickets, okay. All right. How many reflexive relations can we make?
Same sets?
Yes. Here, can you, as such, how many reflexive relations can we make? Two to the what?
Six.
How do you know?
I just thought of, like, the matrix is 3 by 3, and the reflexive, it's, it includes the diagonals. They're the 1, 1s, the 2, 2s. So
okay.
That diagonal. And then the either the top or the bottom, if one's in it, another one has to be. So I just counted just the top one. So it's those 6 elements that are either in it or not.
Okay. All right, and it's not wrong. it's not my thought process, but well, there's, so suppose, I guess I should have specified, this is A relates A, obviously, because A relates B, they don't have the same elements, right? So 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 3, 1, 3, 2, 3, 3. Okay, so I can do the same thing that I did before. I can have each character represent one of the possible ordered pairs, and the value that I put there is going to depend on how many options I can assign. So 2, 1, it can either be in or it cannot. 3, 1, it can be either in or not. But 2, 2 has to be in the set. Okay? So instead of a bunch of twos multiplied together, I actually have a couple of ones in there. Okay? If you want to be fastidious. So this is how I understand these problems to work. All right? Now, when I write a 2 here, I mean that it is either in the set or it is not in the set. There are two possibilities there, in or out. For 1, 1, there are not two possibilities. It must be in the set. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so that's the possibilities.
Okay. How many relations if A relates A, I will specify this time, are symmetric?
Disjoint sets.
Disjoint sets. So I think you're on the right track. So here's what that reminds me of. Ronald McDonald, right? So this problem is like that problem. We have to make a super letter. I'm going to draw out. One, one, two, two, three, three. Okay. Those are by themselves. 1, 2, 2, 1. 1, 3, 3, 1. 2, 3, 3, 2. Okay? They're like super letters, kind of like Ronald McDonald. This can either be in or out. Times in or out. In or out. So, how many options are there for the super letter 1, 2, 2, 1? Yes, either both are in or both are out. So it's 2 to the 6th. Does it make sense? How how many relations of A onto A are anti-symmetric? What is it?
I said 2 to the 3rd.
2 to the 3rd? Okay, so we have 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3. They're gonna be in there, right? Say it again? Shouldn't it be 1 instead of 2? Oh, no, so does anti-symmetric care whether 1, 1 is in there? No, it doesn't care. It allows them, they're not mandatory, right? So, that's true. What do we do about the symmetric pairs? Yes, we're going to have to look at them as super letters. Now, hold on, there's a trick to this one. It's not that hard, I don't think, but we'll see. How many options are there for this super letter? So, you can have neither, right? You can have this one, or you can have this one. You just can't have both. These are 3. Does that make sense? All right. I have like 5 minutes, right? Time? I have no minutes. Oh, that's a shame. Okay. All right. That is what it is. Was that helpful?